Oh, she brought you a packet.
Yeah.
Didn't have number one in it.
Right.
Okay, let's look at number two. Let's have Caitlin Band close with this. Just read the worksheet and then the conclusion.
Okay. So for rhythm, I got normal sinus, heart rate 75, PR is 0.16, QRS is 0.04, and the QT was 0.4. For my means QRS frontal axis, I got 60. Pattern of tracing, age determinant on 2, 3, and AVF. And then I...
Age and determinant of what?
I just wrote inferior ischemia. I don't know.
Okay.
I didn't write anything.
Okay, so in 2, 3, and AVF, you're reading the STT waves, right?
Mm-hmm.
What else is there? What happens in the QRS first in 2, 3, and AVF?
So the T wave inversion?
It goes down.
Yeah.
The QRS goes down. What do we call that? A Q wave. Q waves mean infarct. So it's an inferior infarct and the age is indeterminate. You're right about that.
Okay. And then I wrote T wave inversion. And then for conclusions, I just wrote sinus rhythm and inferior ischemia.
Okay, but it's an inferior infarct.
Inferior infarct.
Everyone see the infarct in 2, 3, and AVF? All right, number three. Ronald Brad. Oh, question?
So, because of the presence of the Q wave, you assume that it's an MI and not.
You don't assume, it is.
And it's not ischemia.
Is it? Huh?
It's not just like an ischemic change? Which
is no, it's an infarct.
Okay.
And the age is indeterminate.
Okay.
Actually, I call it a Q. Anyone else call it a Q? Let's look at two. Here's what's going on. That's sort of what it looks like, right? Now, I said to be an observer out here and look down on the ST segment, and it's convex. There's nothing concave about that ST segment. So because that ST segment is convex, it's an acute infarct. Did anyone call it an acute infarct? Two or three people did. Okay, I did too. Alright. It's not as important to decide whether that's acute or age indeterminate as it is to recognize the Q waves. Number three. So you've got a Q wave in 3 and F, you don't have a Q wave in 2. Now it turns out that we're going to see this later on. If the Q wave is isolated in lead 3, meaning it's not there in 2 and it's not there in F, then it's a normal finding. But if there's a Q wave in 3 and there's also a Q wave in either 2 or F, we call it an inferior infarction. Okay, did you said something about ischemia elsewhere?
Anterior atrial septal ischemia.
Anterior atrial, did you say?
Yeah.
Okay, so someone came up to me after lecture Monday and said, or maybe you said it out loud, we had a lecturer who said that V1 and V2 were septal. You said V2 and V3 were septal. Okay, what that tells you is that V1, V2, and V3 are anteroseptal. They're anteroseptal. Let's not get into a fist fight about whether they're anterior or whether they're septal. They're anteroseptal. They're not atrial. They're anteroseptal. So what you've got is you've got anteroseptal. Actually, I call it anterolateral ischemia. Because there are T wave inversions, V1 through V5. And we said we were going to call T wave inversions ischemia. And they're all the way from V1 to V5. So they involve some lateral leads, that's V4 and V5. And they involve the anteroseptal leads, that's V1 through V3. So I call that anterolateral ischemia. Calling it anterolateral implies that the septum's involved. We don't have to say anteroseptal lateral. It implies it. It means you've got a lot of ischemia all the way from the anterior wall of the heart to the lateral wall of the left ventricle. Okay?
I thought I saw some injury, like some convex ST segments in V1 through V4. Is that incorrect?
Yeah, so if you called this anterolateral injury, it would not be wrong.
Okay.
What was the ischemia in? It was lateral?
It was in anterolateral. V1, V2, V3, V4, V5. Yes?
So I had on V1 through 4, I had elongated PR waves,
elongated
PR wave, like
PR interval?
So I put AV block.
So.
Because I got a 0.24.
And what lead did you see that?
Yeah. You V1. Remember?
What?
V1 and V4.
Okay. Something I didn't tell you Monday is that these intervals, the PR, the QRS, the QT, should only be looked at in the limb leads, not in the V leads. Okay. Don't look at them in the V leads. Just do the intervals in the limb leads. I don't know why that is. It is a rule. Yeah. Yeah, he called it. It's an inferior. Anything else on 3? 4. Wait.
Sorry, I'm probably not the wrong and right.
Dr. Badak, what did you get for the QRS for that one? I'm sorry. For the means QRS frontal axis.
Plus or minus 40.
Okay.
So I call it left axis deviation. Anybody else get it? Greater than minus 30? Okay. Again, it's not something we're going to write. We're not going to fist fight over. We're just going to measure it, and we're going to get close. Minus 20 and minus 40 aren't bad. Problem is, one's a diagnosis and one isn't. But again, the computer in this machine is going to do it better than you and I can. I don't care whether you get it right. I don't care if you do the triangles. Yeah.
If there is a Q wave in wave 3 and AVF along with the convex, would that be in a Q and I?
Well, it's an inferior MI. The question is, what are those STT waves doing? The T waves are inverted in 3.5. Then the question is, what's the ST segment doing? So this is either an age indeterminate inferior infarct or an acute inferior infarct, and we're not going to have a fist fight about that either. Okay? All right. Number 4. Ashley?
So I have a heart rate of 90, PR of 0.12, QRS of 0.08, QT, I could be wrong because I was accidentally using AVR instead of AVF, but I did get negative 30. That might be wrong. I said that it was a sinus rhythm. I saw some Q waves that had negative deflect in leads 2, 3, and AVF. And then I also saw maybe an inverted T wave in V1.
Conclusions?
Possible LAD because my QRS axis, I got negative 30. It's right on the line. In sinus rhythm.
You said you had Q waves in 2, 3, and AVF?
2, 3, and AVF, yep.
Yeah. What did Q waves in 2, 3, and AVF lead us to conclude? Q waves are infarcts. 2, 3, and AVF are the inferior leads. So you have an inferior infarct. What's its age?
Now.
How many want acute? Yeah, it's a convex ST segment with an inverted T wave. So this is an acute inferior infarction. I've got a frontal axis of minus 75 to minus 80. Anyone else?
70.
So this is left axis deviation.
I wrote it on there twice.
What?
What? Can you repeat what the QT was that you got?
The QT I got was 0.40. All right, now look at V1 through V4. You had a question?
I did. You said to ignore AVR unless it's pointing up. Am I
incorrect? Well, I tell you what, I just keep ignoring it.
Regardless of whether it's right up or just
keep ignoring it.
The
I get to look at it on occasion. You don't ever get to look at it. Yeah.
Okay, we had a guest lecture, and he said he kept calling the LDLs for the bunny ears were indicative of a left heart bundle blockage. And I saw him on leads 3 and 2.
He called them
bunny ears.
Bunny ears. He called it a left axis deviate. He called it a left bundle branch block.
No, he said or a right bundle. V1 and V6.
Just V1 and V6?
Uh-huh.
Okay.
We'll talk about that a little later.
Yeah. Okay.
Bunny ears. It's damn near Easter, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, look at V1 through V4. And remember that. What is supposed to happen is that in V1 you're supposed to have a little R wave and a deep S. In V2 you're supposed to have a little more R wave and a little less S. In V3 they should be maybe about the same. And in V4 a little more R and a little less S. Right? Do you remember that? Do you remember why? So this is normal progression of the R wave is what I've just drawn. If you look at this EKG, the R wave doesn't budge until V3. It's the same in V1, same in V2, same in V3. So what am I to conclude about that? It looks a little funny, right? And what it means is there's not quite enough energy coming to the anterior wall of the left ventricle in V2 and V3. I don't know exactly why, but I note that as calling it abnormal R-wave progression in the anterior leads. I just note it, okay? Now, the reason you're going to be seeing EKGs read differently by different people is that some people have a job where they sit in the heart station and read EKGs all day. Or this week they have to read all the EKGs for the hospital. They don't have a clue who the patient is. They don't have a clue what the patient complained about. And they don't have a clue why anyone ordered this test. So they have a tendency to read the EKGs in a sort of conservative way. And we're going to talk a little bit more about that later this morning. And one of these conservative ways is for me to say, well, there's poor progression of the R waves in the anterior leads. I don't know why, I don't strike out. Okay, any other questions about form?
I do. Would this be what you would hear as a STEMI?
Okay, yeah, so STEMI. What is STEMI called?
ST elevation.
ST elevation myocardial infarction. Yeah, STEMI is a term that came into clinical medicine after I trained. And I worked hard to try to figure out how it changed what I learned, and it didn't. So what STEMI means is, I think what it means, is that there's an ST segment elevation, and the enzymes are positive in a situation that makes us think maybe the patient's having a heart attack. So you can have a non-Q wave STEMI.
Okay.
Right? You can have an injury. What I'm telling you is an injury pattern. That's an ST segment elevation. With positive enzymes and no Q wave, and that's a heart attack. Just wait a couple of days and there'll be a Q wave. But I think that's what STEMI means. All right. Yeah.
I have a really quick question. So I saw some ST depression in V4 and V5.
Yeah.
Could that be considered like reciprocal changes due to...
Okay, good pickup. So there's ST segment depression in V4 and 5 of 1 millimeter. Okay. And so this gets back to... So what does ST segment depression mean? You said it's reciprocal?
That's what I was wondering, but it could be a possible
sign of ischemia, right? Okay, it would be reciprocal for, reciprocal changes are changes you see in the electrocardiogram on the other side of the heart. So we know that on the inferior wall, which is down here, on the inferior wall we have an acute heart attack, and the ST segments are doing this. So she's suggesting that over here on the lateral wall, the ST segments are reciprocally going down instead of up. And that's probably exactly what's happening. Now, ST segment depression can also be a sign of other things, including ischemia. If we don't know what's going on, we include it in a, under a, phrase, primary STT wave changes. We're going to use that term in a minute. I might say there are some primary STT wave changes, but probably if I'm reading this and I want to speak to that, I would call it a reciprocal change. I might just ignore it. Okay, number five. Let's see.
For the rhythm, I got sinus rhythm, I got a heart rate of 80, a PR of 0.20, QRS of 0.12, QT of 0.52, the axis a positive 25, and then the pattern of tracing, I got Q waves with upright T waves, V2 through V6.
Conclusions?
Sinus rhythm and old infarct and lateral aspect.
Okay. All right. Let's go back to the intervals. Did anyone get a PR interval greater than 0.20?
Yes.
Several. Okay. So now, when you're looking at the intervals in the limb leads and it's 0.20, then you have to ask yourself, is this a first degree AV block or not? And the way to answer that question is to look at V1 and V6. Does V1 look like a right bundle branch block? Yes. There are your bunny ears. There are your bunny ears. That's a right bundle branch block. Or if you are married to a PR interval of 0.20, it's an incomplete right bundle branch block. But that's what those rabbit ears are doing in in V1. The conduction in the right bundle is delayed. So what I do is I cheat. This looks like a right bundle. V1 looks like a right bundle. So my PR interval is 0.21. I got 0.20 when I read it. But then I saw V1. Oh, there's the right bundle. So I went back and changed it to 0.21. Because I don't like incomplete right bundle. This is happening all the time when people are reading EKGs. Now, it turns out that if we take three cardiologists and have them go through this book, they will agree on these EKGs, maybe at a rate of 0.51. If we have two looking at them, they have a chance at 0.50 by luck alone, right? 0.51 ain't much better than that. That's why we don't want to get too married to these things. What we really want to do is to be able to pick up the necessary things that need to be picked up when we grab an EKG in the ER, or when we look at an EKG in our office and the patient's complaining of chest discomfort.
Which lead was the QRS seen wider than, I'm not seeing
the what, the QRS?
Yeah, because I rolled out the whole branch because I thought it was narrow.
Okay, so I would look at AVF. And it is 0.12. I mean, it's just right on 0.12. The problem here is that the pattern looks like a right bundle. So I call the QRS 0.13.
Okay.
All right. Who's going to argue with me on that? Right. We can argue. We won't hit each other. Yeah.
Is that on broad S wave also something that you would see in
front of
the branch?
Broad S wave in what?
In like V5, V6.
Yes. Okay, so let's assume that we've decided the QRS is 0.13. So we do have a bundle branch block. To try to figure out whether it's right or left, one of the things we can do is look at V1 and see if there are bunny ears, and if there are, it's a right bundle. If we can't figure it out, we look at V6, and the question we ask is, what's the area under the curve late in the QRS? Positive or negative?
Negative.
That's always true in a right bundle. All right, now, you've got some other problems to deal with. No, we don't. Did anyone call this anterior ischemia because of an inverted T wave in V1? You did. Anyone else?
Okay.
Well, it is. We're going to get to it on a later EKG, so we'll skip that. Okay. Yeah. Okay.
I got a different QRS frontal axis. I got -5.
Oh, I got a -50. Okay, so let's talk about this axis. I taught you to look at 1, 2, 3 in AVF and count how many boxes it was below and above the line, and then draw your arrows using that number. That's kind of right. And it works every time the QRS is normal. Every time the QRS is narrow, it works every time. When the QRS is too wide, we have to sort of wonder about the area under the curve. Pesky calculus thing. You have to kind of worry about the area under the curve. And if you look at AVF, the area under the curve below the line is twice or three times more than the area under the curve above the line. So instead of lead 3 being, 3 below and 1 above, like a -2, I would say it's probably a -6. You know, because the area under the curve below the line is so big. That's why my axis is up all the way to minus 50. Not a huge issue, but that's why we're so different. I'm not, when the QRS gets too wide, you thought I told you everything I'm going to do. Just enough to get you to Wednesday. So when the QRS gets too wide, area under the curve starts making a difference.
So, because that was kind of something we worked on these together, and you got something way different than I did, because I did AVF as zero.
As zero?
I thought they were maybe equal, because I wasn't doing area, like, equally above and below the line, so that dropped my...
No, I think if you just look at below and above the line, I think an AVF is three below the line and one above the line. Is that what you got?
Yeah, I got negative 40.
So, yeah, I got a negative 15. You see what I'm saying? It's Did I get, so the question is, did I get possible LVH, left atrial hypertrophy? No.
I didn't remember four.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Well, I'm really pleased that you measured all of that. But the V1 we're going to cover here in a couple of EKGs. It's not strained. It's that T wave is inverted because of the bundle branch block. And I don't think that, so intrinsicoid deflection, I think it's less than 1.4, even in V5. Right at that. Okay. No fist fights over left ventricular hypertrophy. If you're really worried about it, you get an echo. Number six.
One more question. I know Brad said told MI when we started. Did he say that it's just the right one or something?
Brand spots,
or is there
an
old MI?
There's no old MI. There's just the left. Number six. Allison joined.
Okay. So my rhythm, I got sinus, I got heart rate of 90, QR, QRS is 0.04, QT 0.36, and the primal line is positive 45, and conclusion is with sinus rhythm.
Anything else? She says this is a normal EKG.
There's a
huge
quantity.
It's in three.
So I know I saw a Q8 in three, and I know you said to ignore it if it's only in three, but I do feel like there is a small Q8 in two, I think possibly too. A small one in ABF, but I can't really tell that.
Okay, so that's true. What is a Q wave? What is a...
It's an obstruction
A Q wave that is enough to call it an infarct has to be one box deep and one box wide, and they're not that big in lead two. They are in lead three. They're not there in two, and they're not there in F. So a Q wave that we're going to call infarct has to be one block wide and one block deep. Anything else on this EKG?
So we kind of call it normal too, but then looking at it now, if you're talking about the right bundle branch block, like it seems like your in V1, or maybe your Q wave is maybe too high.
Well, the Q wave might be a little too high. I mean, the R wave might be a little too high, but that's not because there's a bundle branch block. There's no rabbit ears.
Okay.
There are no bunny ears. The question is not, is the R wave too high? The question says, what happens with the progression? Does it keep getting bigger in V1, V2, and V3? And the answer is yes. It doesn't ever really transition. There's no S wave over in 4, 5, and 6. So that RS progression is a little abnormal. But there's nothing you can diagnose here. I think this is a normal EKG. F1, number 7.
two.
Who did you say?
So for the rhythm, I got sinus. My heart rate was roughly 65. My PR was 0.12. QRS up 0.08. QT 0.32. My axis was plus 30. My pattern of tracing was V1 through V4. And with the T wave inversion. And so I came up with anterior ischemia.
Anterior ischemia. Anything else on the CKG?
Convex
ST
segment, maybe
1V2
maybe?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're a little bit convex.
That's what I
mean. If you want to call it injury.
Injury.
You want to call it. Okay. So what is injury? It's a little, it's bad ischemia. Okay, number eight. Keep calm.
For the rhythm, I got sinus, heart rate 60, PR 0.16, QRS 0.04, QT 0.36. The means of the frontal access, I got plus 80. For the pattern of tracing, I said ST elevation at 2.3 and ADF, Q wave at V1 and V2. So this was an inferior amount.
Okay, your Q waves were where?
V1 and V2.
In V1 and V2, the first thing happening in the ventricular depolarization curve is up. Okay? Okay? I don't think there are any Q waves. Now, in lead 3, there's a little negative deflection early, but it's not wide enough or deep enough to be a Q wave.
What about AVL?
How about AVL? There's a... Yeah, it's hard to... Yeah, it looks like a... Looks like there might be a Q wave in AVL. Which lead is AVL?
Inverted Q waves.
Where is it? What's it reflecting? What part of the heart?
Lateral.
What are the other lateral leads?
V4, 5, and 6.
4, 5, and 6. Do they have a Q wave?
No.
Not really. Maybe a tiny one in 5 and 6. So, a finding like this causes some heartburn among some people. If you called this possible lateral infarction, you wouldn't be wrong. But there's not much evidence besides this abnormal QRS in the lead AVL. So, don't worry about it. If you called it a normal EKG, which is what I call it, that's fine. If you call it a possible lateral infarction, that's okay too. Yeah.
I thought I saw ST elevation 4, 5, and 6, but
in
V4.
Ah. Yeah, you do. Yeah, the question is, okay, so let's look at V5. The problem is, where does the ST segment begin?
Above the oscillator.
And it's really, really hard to figure out where the ST segment begins. So the question to ask yourself is this a pretty picture or is this an ugly picture? Elevation of the ST segment and depression of the ST segment seldom by themselves make any diagnosis. Seldom do they make any diagnosis, unless that ST segment is convex. When it's concave, it's a much prettier picture. Okay? All right, so inverted T waves. Did anyone get upset about the inverted T wave in V1? Call it anterior ischemia? If it's isolated in V1, an inverted T wave is normal. And then there are exceptions to the T-wave rule, isolated in V1, and T-waves associated with bundle branch blocks. What is the physiologic phenomenon that the T-wave is riding? Ventricular repolarization. What is the physiologic phenomenon the QRS is riding? Ventricular depolarization. in a bundle branch block, ventricular depolarization of either the right ventricle or the left ventricle is always abnormal, right? Abnormal in terms of time, it's abnormal in terms of the pathway of the electricity. The depolarization is abnormal. So, repolarization is abnormal. Okay? So the way you figure out if the T waves are right or not in a bundle branch block is the following. Let's look at a right bundle in V1. That's a right bundle in V1, right? It's got the bunny ears. The way you decide whether this T wave is right or not is that it should be opposite direction of the last portion of the QRS, no matter what's going on. If there's a bundle branch block, that's what ought to happen. In a V6, in a left bundle, it looks like this. That's a left bundle in V6. And sure enough, the T wave is opposite the last portion of the QRS. So that is that's a secondary T wave change. A while ago I said there are some primary ST T wave changes. This is a secondary T wave change. It's an inverted T wave, but a secondary to the left bundle. Isolated in V1, normal finding. Inverted in a bundle branch block, it's normal if it's opposite the direction of the last portion of the QRS. Now, what if you have a left bundle in V6, it looks like that, and the T wave is upright? Not good. It's not right. That's a primary T wave change. Damn, I must have remembered. Bundle branch blocks, T waves. Bundle branch blocks, T waves. Yeah.
How about the rhythm? I didn't feel like it was consistent in all of the, like the heart rate. I got 55 for one, 77 for another. I think that one probably just counting wrong.
You're probably counting right. You're probably counting right. So that's a sinus irregularity. There's a P wave causing every QRS, but that's a sinus, just a sinus variation. Nine. Julie Matthews. Or Matthews. Julie Matthews. Ventricular tachycardia. Anyone get anything else? Okay, so what's the deal with ventricular tachycardia? What's the next question? Before you, how do you decide whether to treat them or how to treat them? You're in the ER, nurse runs down and says, hey, this patient's in VTAC. Your heart rate goes from 60 to 107 in an instant, and you run down the room. What's the question?
Is it regular?
Are they awake? Yeah. If they're awake and reciting the Gettysburg Address, here's a hint. Don't shop. It hurts. And you might get a fist in the face. Okay. If they're unconscious, you shock them. If they're conscious, then you consider a pharmacologic maneuver. You've got some time to stand there and think if they're awake. I was a senior medical student one time. I was rotating with a cardiologist, and we were standing at the bedside. He had an elderly lady in there. I think she had a myocardial infarct, and I can't remember exactly. We were literally at the bedside, and her eyes rolled up. We looked at the monitor, and she went into VTAC. And he blasted her in the chest with a thump, and she converted to a sinus rhythm, and she opened her eyes and she said, don't you ever hit me in the chest again. That almost never happens because they almost never pass out on your right you're standing there. But it was really interesting. I almost burst out laughing. Okay, so that's VTAC. Good read. Okay, number.
I have a question.
Yeah. Yeah. No, you just have to choose and just draw a line. And you don't really care. But it's VTAC, you don't care about all this other stuff. All you care about is the VTAC, because it's potentially lethal. The problem with VTAC is if you don't get them converted, it'll turn into VFib. That's the problem with VTAC. Okay?
He said you don't convert them.
Oh, there's an alternative reading here. There's an alternative reading. If they are awake and they just came in because they were kind of dizzy and not feeling quite right, and you get this EKG, this might not be VTAC. This might be atrial flutter. Did anyone call it atrial flutter because the rate was real close to 150? This might be atrial flutter with aberrant conduction through the ventricle. So if the patient previously had a left bundle branch block, the left bundle branch block is probably a permanent conduction abnormality, and then they go into atrial flutter, their EKG could look just like this. Because the QRS is wide in a bundle branch block, right? So you don't have to worry about that. You don't have to worry about trying to figure out, is this atrial flutter with aberrant conduction or is this VTAC? You don't have to worry about that. You just call this VTAC, because that's the important thing. And then the next question is, are they awake? And if it's VTAC and they're awake, you got time to get some help before you do something. If they're unconscious and you have the CKG, you shock them. It's pretty simple. Okay, number 10, this will be our last one for today. Any thoughts?
Okay, I have sinus rhythm, heart rate 75, PR at 0.08, QRS at 0.05, QT at 0.48, and for the axis I got negative 25. I put inverted T waves in V1, 2, and 3, the isolated Q wave in 3, and then I kind of wondered if those would be considered prolonged QT waves. Just they seemed longer than most of them we've seen.
Yeah, so to know whether the QT is too long or not, you have to look at a table.
Okay.
Because it's rate dependent.
Okay.
What's the QRS? What's the QRS interval?
I have 0.05.
Look at lead 2. I bet you got tricked by that wide S wave.
Okay.
There's an R and then there's a wide S wave like a scoop, right?
Mm-hmm.
You see it now? So it's hugging up against 0.12. Did anyone call this a bundle branch block? Okay, so let's look and see if there are bunny ears in V1. Oh, it's lop-eared. That's a lop-eared bunny, but there's a tiny R, then that's a big R wave. So that's or an R prime. So that's RSR prime. And what's the area under the curve in V6? Negative. So this is a right bundle. How about those T waves inverted in V1, V2, V3? Antroceptal ischemia. What else could they be?
It's normal.
Normal, because we have a bundle branch block, and so there's secondary ST T waves. There's secondary T wave changes because we have a bundle branch block. The T waves are supposed to be opposite the direction of the last portion of the QRS. The area under the curve, late in the QRS. Okay. Anything we've covered today that's unclear? Yeah. had a right bundle branch block and the T waves in D1, D2, and D3 are upright, then they are primary T wave changes. Okay? Under the term primary T wave changes, you've got a whole list of things. It might be ischemia, it might be hypokalemia, it might be a variety of things that do things to T waves. But what I call them is just primary T wave changes, secondary T waves. All right, so. Any other questions?
The last one I did,
so we'll do 10 more. Oh, I got new books for you. This time they don't have answers in them. I have no clue what happened. I went over to the print shop, and the answer I got was, I did this exact same thing last year. I scanned it into my computer, printed out the books, and they didn't have any answers. She said to me, I've got that in my computer, so if you need any more books, just call me and I'll print them out. So I did. I called her and she printed them out. Someone printed them out. She told me the woman that printed, I was out that day, the woman that printed them, I fired 2 weeks ago. I don't know, maybe it's United Airlines, I don't know. Just pick one up on your way out.
Yeah.